following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
So it is. Welcome to a new week, everyone. It's another Monday. Here we go again. Hi, I'm Nicole Sandler, coming to you live at NicoleSandler.com on the Progressive Voices Network, Periscope, Twitch, Facebook Live, and today is October 12th. Theoretically, my YouTube suspension is up in 2 days. 3 months flew by, so to speak. I'll take bets on whether or not, YouTube will allow me to stream again come Wednesday. I'm guessing probably not, because, you know, it's Google. Google owns YouTube, and I have no faith in them. We'll see. Maybe they'll surprise me. So, not only is today October 12th, it is Indigenous Peoples Day. Now, I know some people still celebrate Columbus Day, but why? Really? You know, it's a good thing that encyclopedias are outdated, that they're no longer viable. We actually have a set of World Book encyclopedias, should anybody need them, but they're obsolete. Honestly, I looked them up to see if I could sell them, if they're worth anything, and they're worth zero. They are worth nothing because you can get an encyclopedia's worth of knowledge at your fingertips. It's called the internet. And, you know, when this set of encyclopedias was published, I looked at the beginning, and this is from 1991. The internet, it may have sort of existed, but not in the sense we know it now. So, and I'm guessing if you looked in the encyclopedia for Columbus, Christopher Columbus, it would give you some very outdated information. Like it might say he discovered America on October 12, 1492. And we know now that's
bullshit.
Right. And you know, Columbus was kind of a murderer and a rapist and not a good guy. So there are many of us who choose to recognize this date as Indigenous Peoples Day, because after all, they're the ones who discovered America, so to speak. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. Now, it is a legal holiday in this country, and it's a day that the Senate is usually not in session. And, oh, I forgot, the Senate is actually in recess right now for 2 weeks. Why? Because there's a pandemic going on, and a number of their ranks have gotten infected. In fact, Senators Mike Lee and Tom Tillis were among those who tested positive after the super spreader event at the White House a couple of weeks ago, where Donald Trump introduced his choice to replace Ruth Bader Ginsburg on the Supreme Court, a woman named Amy Coney Barrett. Amy Coney Barrett was irresponsible enough to show up at this event at the White House without a mask and to bring 6 of her 7 children with her. Apparently, one is a special needs kid who has the youngest, I believe, who has Down syndrome, who was left at home. But the other 6 kids were there. And guess what? None of them wore a mask. And now we know that this event turned out to be a super spreader, where that they've already traced back at least like 30 people to this event. There would probably be more, except the White House refused to do any contact tracing. You heard that right. The CDC, the Centers for Disease Control, came and said, we'll do the contact tracing for you. And the White House said, yeah, thanks, but no thanks. We're good. And they ignored it. They didn't do any contact tracing. Families and friends of people who got infected at this event, never heard from anyone. And then today, so the Senate is on recess. There is no floor activity in the Senate, but even when the Senate is in recess, committees can still do work. And it is under that heading, I suppose, that Lindsey Graham decided today would be the day they would start the Senate Judiciary Committee hearings on the confirmation of Amy Coney Barrett to the Supreme Court. Because, you know, first she's got to be approved by the committee and then voted out of committee, and then it goes to the full House, for the full Senate, the full chamber. Well, the full chamber is on recess because there's a pandemic spreading through the U.S. Senate. Now, Mike Lee, one of the senators who tested positive after the super spreader event at the White House, showed up today. Not only was he there in the hearing room, he wasn't wearing a mask. I really don't, look, I don't know why anybody was in that room who didn't physically have to be there. Some senators, Kamala Harris, for one, did it remotely, as you are allowed to do now because we've got a pandemic going on. So she did, although I got to say, I don't know if it's the Senate's AV person. AV stands for audiovisual. I was an AV person in my elementary school. I think I was the first girl to ever volunteer, but I wanted to run the projector. I guess it portended things to come. But anyway, when they first brought up her audio, there was a feedback loop. And then she was so overmodulated, you could barely hear what she was saying. And believe me, I know from overmodulated audio, as do you if you listen to the show. So, but nonetheless, people showed up and they sat in that room. Lindsey Graham didn't wear a mask. Mike Lee, who we know was infected as of a week ago, didn't wear a mask. I would have seen that. I would have said, excuse me, I'm out of here. I'll zoom in to make my statement and ask my questions. Although there was no questions today. Today was each member of the Senate Judiciary Committee, and there are 22 of them, each one got to make an opening statement. Really? An opening? 10 minutes. They each got 10 minutes for an opening statement. Then Lindsey Graham called on two or three witnesses, whatever, to speak in support of Amy Coney Barrett, and she got to do her opening remarks, which could have gone on, I'm guessing, for a while. I think she limited them to like 7 minutes because she just doesn't have that much to say. Actually, she probably does, but she knows that the things she would say would render her unfit to sit on the highest court in the land. The whole thing is so depressing. There were a couple of lovely moments, and I'll go through some of them with you. And there were some not so lovely moments. So we can start with, you know, Lindsey Graham. I know I'd prefer not to as well. And guess what? In 23 days or so, how many days? 20 some odd days, you have the opportunity to vote Miss Lindsey out of office. And it's looking pretty good. In fact, I've got this in the regular What's News today, but Jamie Harrison, who is Lindsey Graham's opponent running for that Senate seat in South Carolina, had a really big quarter, just releasing third quarter October, November. Yeah, the third quarter ended at the end of September, so the third quarter tallies are now coming in, and I want to read it to you because I don't want to screw it up. But this is kind of huge. Here we go. Is this it? Okay. Yes. So Friday night there was supposed to be a debate. It would have been the second debate between Lindsey Graham and Jamie Harrison. Jamie Harrison demanded that Lindsey Graham take a COVID test before he'd get on stage with him. Jamie Harrison, good move, because Lindsey Graham hangs out with Donald Trump, who refuses to wear a mask and, oh, by the way, is COVID positive. So Lindsey Graham refused to take a test. So Harrison pulled out of the debate. There was no debate Friday night. Meanwhile, while Graham is suffering with more than possible COVID contamination, Jamie Harrison released his latest fundraising numbers, posting a record $57 million haul for third quarter, breaking every record in the books. For comparison's sake, the previous record was $38 million raised in one quarter by former Congressman Beto O'Rourke in his 2018 bid to unseat then Senator Ted Cruz, who unfortunately is still a senator, sits on the Judiciary Committee and did his questioning today remotely. Because he may be an asshole, but he's not stupid, and he knows there are infected people in that chamber. So, anyway, I digress. Today, day one of the confirmation hearings, saw all the senators on the committee do their 10-minute opening statements, and Amy Coney Barrett made her statement, and then they adjourned until tomorrow, and the next 2 days is going to be really busy. But Lindsey Graham, who chairs the committee and gets the big hypocrite award of the day. And believe me, that's saying something, because there's a lot of competition in that room for that dishonor. He started, kicked things off by stating the obvious.
This is an election year.
You think?
We're confirming the judge in an election year after the voting has occurred.
Yeah.
What will happen is that my Democratic colleagues will say, this has never been done, and they're right in this regard. Nobody's, I think, has ever been confirmed in election year.
You're a hypocrite.
Hypocrite. The bottom line is, Justice Ginsburg, when asked about this several years ago, said that a president serves for 4 years, not three. There's nothing unconstitutional about this process. This is a vacancy that's occurred through a tragic loss of a great woman.
Well, that's the first true thing you've said.
And we're going to fill that vacancy with another great woman.
No.
The bottom line
not
here
if we can help
is
it.
That the Senate is doing its duty constitutionally.
Hey, Lindsey, I don't care in this one instance what Justice Ginsburg said. What about what you said? Lindsey Graham is the biggest fucking hypocrite on the face of the earth. Let's have a little listen to something he said at the Atlantic Conference back on October 8th. Just over 2 years ago, October 8th, 2018. And notice, it was 2018. It was well after the 2016 elections, well after the Brett Kavanaugh hearings, well after any of that nonsense. Lindsey Graham looked at, oh, you know what? I've got the video to play for you. It's not this one. Never mind. I have a different video to play for you. Lindsey Graham looked at Jeffrey Goldberg, the editor of The Atlantic, and said this.
I was just going to, he's not North Korea.
No,
but
he's
this,
not. But,
you
want to
do 30 seconds on Merrick Garland?
Judge Scalia dies.
Yes.
In 2016.
Yes, he did.
The primary process is ongoing.
Yes, it was.
And if you look back in 100 years, nobody has been replaced under that circumstance.
That's right.
If you listen to what Joe Biden said in Bush 41, you should hold it over to the next election.
Yes.
Joe is right a lot. So I felt like I was doing the traditional thing there.
Yeah.
When it came to Sotomayor and Kagan, I thought I did the traditional thing.
Okay.
And I'll tell you this.
What?
This may make you feel better, but I really don't care.
Okay.
If an opening comes in the last year of President Trump's term.
Okay.
And the primary process has started.
Yes, it has.
We'll wait to the next election.
Really?
And I've got a pretty good chance of being the judiciary.
You're on the record.
You are. You're the chair of the judiciary.
Hold the tape.
Okay, hold the tape, he said at the very, sorry, I stepped on it. At the very end of that, he said, let's bring it up again.
I've got a pretty good chance being the judiciary.
You're on the record.
Yeah.
All right.
Hold the tape.
Hold the tape! Hold the tape! Lindsey, what happened to you?
As to Judge Garland, the opening that occurred with the passing of Justice Scalia was in the early part of an election year.
Yeah.
The primary process had just started.
Yeah.
And we can talk about history, but here's the history as I understand it. There's never been a situation where you had a president of one party in the Senate of another.
It doesn't matter.
Where the nominee, the replacement, was made in election year. It's been over 140 years ago.
It doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. Lindsey Graham, do you have any integrity at all?
If an opening comes in the last year of President Trump's term and the primary process has started, we'll wait to the next election. And I've got a pretty good chance of being the judiciary.
You're on the record.
Yeah.
All right. Hold that tape.
Hold the tape.
Hold the tape. fucking liar. Lindsey Graham, you are a liar. Liar, 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 liar. All right, he doesn't care because he's a hypocrite. A hypocrite and a liar. This is what we're dealing with here. So, like I said, everybody got to do their 10-minute intros. And Kamala Harris was one of them. And she made some great points. If only her audio wasn't screwed up.
This hearing has brought together more than 50 people to sit inside of a closed-door room for hours while our nation is facing a deadly airborne virus.
This is embarrassing.
The committee has ignored common sense requests to keep people safe, including not requiring testing for all members, despite a coronavirus outbreak among senators of this very committee. By contrast, in response to this recent Senate outbreak,
the
leaders of Senate Republicans rightly postponed business on the Senate floor this week.
They did. As I told you, the Senate's closed.
To protect the health and safety of senators and staff. Mr. Chairman, for the same reasons, this hearing should have been postponed.
Yes, it should have.
The decision to hold this hearing now is reckless and places facilities workers, janitorial staff,
everybody,
and congressional aides and Capitol Police at risk. Not to mention that while tens of millions of Americans are struggling to pay their bills, the Senate should be prioritizing coronavirus relief and providing financial support to those families. The American people need to have help to
you
make
think?
Rent or their mortgage payment. We should provide financial assistance to those who have lost their job.
Yes,
and
we
help
should.
Parents put food on the table.
Yep.
Small businesses need help, as do the cities, towns, and hospitals that this crisis has pushed to the brink. The House bill would help families and small businesses get through this crisis. But Senate Republicans have not lifted a finger for 150 days, which is how long that bill has been here in the Senate, to move the bill.
That's right. First of all, that's sickening that her audio was so bad. The Republicans control the committee. That means they control the controls. They control whoever runs the audio and the video. And I promise you, that was no mistake. There was no excuse for it whatsoever. That was worse than the worst audio on this program ever. And my audio is fucked up all the time. It's just shameful. But this is how that stuff rolls. This is how the Republicans in the United States of America in the year 2020 behave. And it's sickening. Trying to think who else to play. Let me play a little bit of Dick Durbin. He's like the number two guy in the Senate. He actually should have been Senate Majority Leader instead of little Chucky Schmucky Schumer. But Dick Durbin, I guess, has a little dick and didn't stand up for his rights. I don't know. I know I'm too hard on the Democrats, but somebody's got to be. That said, Dick Durbin was good today.
It has been recounted earlier that Justice Ginsburg was approved by the Senate by a 96-3 vote.
Yeah, that's true.
This icon of liberal thinking, advocate for the ACLU, 96-3 before the United States Senate. And then Anton Scalia, on the opposite polar end of the political spectrum, approved 98-0. Amazing. Can this be the same Senate? It's not. The reason those votes were so overwhelming was because people lived by the rules, they lived by the traditions of the Senate, and they had mutual respect for one another. We know now that this process does not adhere to those guidelines. The haste in this pursuit that before us today is unfair to the Senate and unfair, really, to the nominee. The nominee before us was announced 16 days ago. The day after Justice Ginsburg lay in state in
Shameful.
The United States Capitol.
Disgusting.
We received the nomination paperwork 13 days ago.
Ugh.
And have learned since then that some materials are missing.
Some materials are missing. She omitted the parts of her disclosure forms where she participated in seminars and gave speeches on ending, overturning Roe v. Wade. She also spoke and wrote at length about overturning the Affordable Care Act. These things she left out. But I'll tell you what the Democrats did today in their opening statements is they ran a concerted play. They all focused on the consequences to all of us should Amy Coney Barrett be confirmed. Because, as they noted, the Supreme Court is scheduled on November 10th, 7 days after Election Day, to take up the case of the Affordable Care Act. The Trump administration is once again working to overturn it. Whatever's left of it, they want to kill it, so we'll be left without insurance. And when I say we, I mean me, and I'm talking to a lot of you who I've heard from personally, we have pre-existing conditions. Me, you know, I'm a lung cancer survivor and a melanoma survivor and a few other things. Anybody who got COVID now has a pre-existing condition. By the way, if you had acne as a teenager and you come down with some horrible form of cancer that would cost an insurance company a fortune, if there's no coverage for pre-existing condition, they will research you and they'll find out you had acne as a teenager and you didn't put it on your application and therefore you are no longer covered. That's what they do. And believe me, I've spent enough hours on the air with Wendell Potter that I know and understand this crap. That's how they work. This all goes to ugly, big, dark money in politics because, you know, all of these assholes on the Republican side and many on the Democratic side, too. I'm not clearing them of responsibility. Vote the way they do because of the money that they get. And the reason they want to kill the Affordable Care Act, there's more money in it for them. In fact, let's do this. I've got an interview to play for you today. I actually recorded it last week, and it's with an author named Jennifer Taub, and she's got a brand new book out called Big Dirty Money, and it's about the influence of big, as the name implies, big dirty money in politics. And there was one moment today in the hearing that just, it was like an intro to that interview for me. It was Senator Sheldon Whitehouse of Rhode Island. It was his turn to ask questions. And what he focused in on, I'll play his first part. It was a regular, here's the first part, a point that he made that I wanted to share.
This hearing itself is a microcosm of Trump's dangerous ineptitude in dealing with the COVID pandemic.
That's
Trump
true.
Can't even keep the White House safe.
True.
Here it's the chairman's job to see to the committee's safety.
Yeah, good luck
and
with that.
And though his words were reassuring, I don't know who
I
has
don't
been
know.
Tested.
We
who
know who
be
hasn't
tested.
Been tested.
Who is a danger?
Yeah.
What contact tracing has been done?
None.
On infected and
None.
Exposed senators and staff.
None.
Nothing.
Nothing.
The whole thing, just like Trump, is an irresponsible botch.
Boom.
The irony is that this slapdash hearing targets the Affordable Care Act.
Yes, it does.
This Supreme Court nominee has signaled in the judicial equivalent of all caps that she believes the Affordable Care Act must go and that the precedent protecting the ACA doesn't matter. The big secretive influences behind this unseemly rush see this nominee as a judicial torpedo they are firing at the ACA.
Huh.
So I hope Republicans consider what's at stake for the many people who depend right now in this pandemic on ACA health coverage.
Oh, yes. But then Sheldon Whitehouse made it personal. And he made it personal against the senior senator from Texas, John Cornyn, who also sits on that committee. And you'll see, if you're watching on video, you'll have the video of this. If not, just listen to the audio. But just know, for part of this, when he's like pointing a finger right at John Cornyn, the TV cameras had a split screen. John Cornyn was not happy about it. Isn't that just too bad? All right, Keep going, Senator Whitehouse.
There's a promise to big donors that must be kept.
Mm-hmm.
When David Koch ran for vice president, he campaigned on getting rid of Medicare and Medicaid.
Yep.
Imagine his fury when Obamacare passed.
Oh, boy.
His groups are spending millions right now on this nomination. Republicans in Congress tried and failed to repeal the ACA more than 70 times. It's in the Republican Party platform for justices to reverse the ACA decision. Trump has over and over said this is his reason.
You hear this?
And now we're in this mad rush to meet the November 10th argument deadline.
Yep.
And colleagues pretend this isn't about the ACA. Right.
Right.
The travel of the ACA case leads to one senator's doorstep. In a Politico article yesterday, the senior senator from Texas,
Cornyn,
tried to say that this rushed process isn't targeting the ACA. But look at the record.
Yes.
The district judge in Texas who struck down the ACA in the case, now headed for the court, is a former aide to the senator, who's become what the Texas Tribune calls the favorite for Texas Republicans seeking big judicial wins like torpedoing the ACA. The senior senator from Texas introduced in committee the circuit court judge who wrote the decision on appeal striking down the ACA. Senator Cornyn has filed brief after brief arguing for striking down the ACA. He led the failed Senate charge to repeal the ACA in 2017. He said, I've introduced and co-sponsored 27 bills to repeal or defund Obamacare, and have voted to do so at every opportunity. And now, talking about socialized medicine, the old Republican battle cry against Medicare, Senator Cornyn and all of our colleagues on this committee are pushing to get this nominee on by November 10th, the time needed to strike down the Affordable Care Act. Please don't tell us this isn't about the Affordable Care Act.
Please don't tell us that.
From Cornyn judge to Cornyn judge to this nominee, hop, hop, hop.
Ooh, and Cornyn
lose their ACA health care protections.
Guffawing.
Hop, 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 to see whose doorstep that sits on. Lost in this hypocritical rush is the legacy of Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Yeah.
Let me close by remembering her for a minute.
All right. And that was the part that I wanted to share with you. Sheldon Whitehouse was brilliant. He usually is. He's kind of a, you know, a low-key kind of guy. But he, you know, when Sheldon Whitehouse speaks, you should listen. So that was a good intro with Day of Talking David Koch and the dark, bad, dark money that influences so many of these elected officials. So we'll take a very quick time out, give our friends at the Progressive Voices Network a chance to take care of some business, and come back on the other side with Jennifer Taub, author of Big Dirty Money. it's the stuff that is behind all of this crap. Yeah, it's, you know, it's money. You can't live with it, can't live without it, but we can get rid of some of the big, dirty money, can't we? That's next. I'll be right back. All right. Well, Progressive Voices isn't a commercial. I thought I'd take this moment to share with you a song. This is not a parody, though. This one actually comes from a guy who I discovered not too long ago, but he's been doing this for a long time. His Roy Zimmerman, I believe he's based on the West Coast, and he does concerts, he does song parodies. He's kind of like a Mark Russell or a Tom Lehrer for today. All right, take it away, Roy Zimmerman.
Way back when they said all men,
they met every wealthy European man.
So back then, to vote required being white,
being rich and being male.
They said, you can't vote if you got no property. You can't vote if you're not free. You can't vote if you are a woman,
cause you got no stake in democracy.
Year by year, people have to wonder what the Declaration must have meant. Electoral adjustment. And they won the vote for those who had no property. Won the vote those who'd been free. Won the vote. Won the vote for women. And they wrote it down. It was guaranteed. They all said, it's my vote.
night again evaporate and float away. And by night, people came creeping and they tried to take the vote away. If you can't vote, you haven't paid the poll tax.
You can't vote,
you can't pass the exam. You can't vote for fear of retribution. And the people stood up and said, well, damn, it's my vote. You can't deny it. My voice can't take it away. My life, I won't be quiet. It's
my vote, my voice, my right.
The rolls. You can't vote. They took away your mailbox.
You can't vote.
The rig in the courts.
Say you're gonna use it.
Say you'll never lose it. And if they ask you whose it is, just say it's my vote.
It's my voice. Yes, it is.
The sounds of despair from former radio personalities languishing in the purgatory of corporate consolidation. These former radio personalities have lost their livelihoods, not because they weren't entertaining or informative, but because they don't meet today's corporate terrestrial broadcast standards of being smelly, overweight douchebags, seething with vein-popping hatred. These radio refugees and their audiences have since migrated to the internet, but their struggle continues as the quest for monetization ensues. Nicole Sandler is leading the way to reestablishing thought-provoking and entertaining radio. And you can help by clicking the donate button on NicoleSandler.com. Donate today, or as much and as often as you can. Dry the tears of listeners by removing the rotting stench of corporate radio. Won't you help?
The Nicole Sandler Show.
The Nicole Sandler Show.
On the Progressive Voices Network.
All right. Joining us on the line now is Jennifer Taub. The occasion is a brand new book. It was just released yesterday. It's called Big Dirty Money, The Shocking Injustice and Unseen Cost of White Collar Crime. Hi, Jennifer. Sorry, that's Jackson in the background making all that noise. It's raining here in Florida, so he can't handle the thunder.
Well, hi, Nicole, and hi, Jackson. I'm sorry I did not bring Sparky into the shot for this occasion.
Well, that's okay. Jackson has enough excitement for the day with the thunder going on. So congratulations on the book. You know, they say timing is everything. And wow, talk about a release of a big book dealing with white collar crime and big dirty money. It comes on the heels of two things. First, about a week and a half ago, a big release from BuzzFeed News and hundreds of other international journalists with the FinCEN files, something that you wrote about before it was a big news item, or I should rephrase that, before it should have been a huge news story. And it seems like all the news organizations kind of ignored it. I understand why. There's a lot going on. But really, shouldn't this have been front page news everywhere?
You know, it's funny. Although it does seem like perfect timing, I've been teaching a course in white collar crime for years. And I swear to you, every semester, it's good timing. Every, you know, whatever I teach it, there's always some big breaking news, some case we have to follow. You know, of late, this seems to be a recurring, you know, flare up, which is now into kind of a full blown epidemic phase. And it's time to find a cure.
Right. Well, Jason Leopold, who was one of the lead reporters on that story for BuzzFeed, is an old, dear, dear friend of mine. So he was on the show last Friday. And it's amazing how many stories have grown out of this release of a massive trove of documents. Things that I guess many of us knew before, but we're seeing banks, international banks, banks from Deutsche Bank, which has been in the news a lot lately, to others, HSBC, which it saw its stock prices tumble in the next session after this report was released. Yet they never seemed to meet with any consequences. Now, I read, Jennifer, that after your first book, which was dealing with the 2008 financial meltdown, a lot of people asked you why no banksters went to jail, why nobody was prosecuted for that. And that was what led you to this second book?
Yeah, I mean, I was really proud. It took me a while to write that book because I dug deeply to see the many decades of deregulation that led to that toxic mortgage supply chain and meltdown, and tragically to pushing millions of people out of their homes in foreclosure. And as a lawyer, I wanted to kind of peel it back, you know, peel back the wall and see the workings, electricity, what's happening there. But, you know, immediately upon publishing it, I realized that I didn't have an answer to that most vital question. Why no big banksters go to jail? And there are others who've tackled that question. One of my friends, Jesse Eisinger, wrote the book, The Chicken Shit Club, and he looked into that. And, you know, I agree with him, and I'm going to, you know, add a few things. The bottom line is no one was prosecuted or went to jail because their mindset, they didn't want to do it.
They meaning the government, didn't want to prosecute it?
Well, I was never in any kind of room or fly in the wall for any discussion. But if you just look at the public statements that were made by the Justice Department, and in particular, Lanny Brewer, who was heading up the Enforcement Division, you're nodding, so I think you might remember that Frontline interview. Mm-hmm. And here's what's so very shocking. He was asked, why did no big bankers go to jail? And his answer is astonishing. He said, well, you know, it's very difficult for us to be able to prove one of the elements of fraud. And he claimed on national TV that one of those elements was that he was going to have to prove that the victims had actually relied on false statements made by the banks about these toxic mortgages. Well, that just set off, you know, alarms in our minds, because reliance is not an element that the government has to prove for criminal fraud. Reliance is often an element for if you and I want to sue someone civilly for fraud, but the government does not have to prove that element. It was so shocking that a federal judge, Jed Rakoff, wrote a piece in the New York Review of Books saying, you know, kind of what's going on here? He's totally wrong on the law. So I'm giving you that one example. Mm-hmm. If you're the head of enforcement and you don't know that, it either means you're not well educated or you didn't bother to become educated. This is a very smart man. And I know if I had a priority and I said there's this obstacle in my way, and I said to people, this is important, but I had this obstacle, and someone pointed out to me, that's not there. It's a mirage. You made a mistake. That's not an obstacle. That I'd like to know that, right? And clearly he didn't have any high-level meetings with anybody where he said it's a priority, but darn it, there's this one obstacle. Because anyone who works for somebody, if your boss says to you, I want to research this and we should investigate this, and you said, but I don't think it's worth investigating because it's always so hard to prove reliance, and you would probably say to your boss, hey, it's not hard to prove it. We don't even have to.
Right.
That conversation either never happened or he's totally unqualified for that job. You know, the second reason you can look at is when Enron, the big Enron meltdown, you might remember, there was a task force. You know who let, you might remember, if you know who headed up the Enron task force?
No.
Andrew Weissman.
Oh, wow.
And they Weissman. Put lots of folks in jail, you know, after the savings and loan crisis.
Well, and he just wrote a book, just released this week, saying that the Mueller investigation was hobbled from the beginning, that they didn't do the job they should have done, and mostly because they were warned away from investigating Donald Trump's finances.
And that's it. The parallels are perfect.
Mm-hmm.
If you're very powerful and you're going to bully and you're going to threaten, the laws don't apply to you because prosecutors back down. What Mueller did is the same thing I believe the Justice Department did after the banking crisis.
Wow. They run away from the confrontation because what? They're afraid? It was like with the Mueller report. What's come out is they were afraid if they dug too deep, they'd be fired. Well, what's worse? Issue an incomplete report?
I think the problem was this, and not defending it, but on the one hand, Mueller had already obviously decided, even if he found sufficient evidence of guilt, he wasn't going to indict.
Mm-hmm.
He'd obviously already decided he wasn't even going to say that. His goal was probably to keep the system together and show that this would be a report that could be a blueprint maybe for an impeachment. I don't, who knows what he was thinking, but it was a huge mistake. When someone says to you, if you're investigating, a murder scene and you see sort of blood dripping out from under the closet door and you're like, what is that? And they say, don't go there. That's a place to look.
Yes, exactly.
Follow the money. We know this.
Follow the money. And that's been your, what you go after. So that led to the first book, Other People's Houses. And it exposed the deregulation that helped cause the 2008 financial crisis. Now, 2020, just yesterday, you released Big Dirty Money. And we mentioned, all right, the FinCEN files that were released a couple of weeks ago that I thought should have been bigger news. But again, Donald Trump, keeps us on our toes with all the shit he throws against the wall on a regular basis. So I get why big, complicated stories oftentimes get pushed off the front pages because they're complicated. And I guess we silly Americans can't deal with that. But then let's go to this Sunday. Another shoe drops. This time it's the New York Times bombshell about Donald Trump's taxes. Lo and behold, they get access to 20 years of his taxes. And we learned that for 15 or 10 of 15 years, he paid nothing. The last 2 years that they were able to get the records from, 2016 and 2017, he paid a grand total of $750 each year. Tax evasion is a white collar crime, too, isn't it?
It absolutely is. It's one of the top white collar crimes along there with money laundering.
Mm-hmm.
I don't mean top in terms of prosecuted. I mean, as a tool for the wealthy and well-connected to gain more power, tax evasion is a great way because it's a way to keep a huge amount of your money. Other folks have to pay their tax bills. And, this is a technique they use. It's really, again, kind of not surprising. You mentioned like this, that this was suddenly, but remember a couple of years ago, the New York Times had another story about how the whole Trump family may have evaded close to, what was it then, $400 million in taxes in today's dollars. And that kind of came out and fizzled. I think this one is going to stick because I do think that number, 750, is something folks have latched onto.
Oh yeah,
and it's really infuriating.
that's one way to put it. It is stunning. In his just the blatant disregard for the responsibility of an American citizen. From now, the president of the United States, and he can't even say, "Well, this was before I became president," because in his first year in the White House, $750. And then, there's a lot of this stuff going on. We also learned this year about apparent insider trading happening in Congress. Senator Richard Burr had to temporarily give up the chairmanship of the Senate Intelligence Committee, but he's still in the Senate. And Kelly Loeffler, who's running for re-election in Georgia, and hopefully the people there will see through her. It seems like they got off with nothing. Like there were red flags raised, and then, oh, never mind, look over there.
So let me say a couple things. First of all, and I know you know this, Kelly Loeffler is not running for re-election. She's running for election. Right?
She was appointed
to the spot, mm-hmm. and within like weeks of her first day in office, she was taking advantage of that position to have her stockbroker sell and buy a whole bunch of investments that sure look like she based those on, even though she denies it, the information she had early on about how devastating COVID was going to be.
Mm-hmm.
As for Senator Burr, that investigation is still ongoing. this is what's critical. Why did the Department of Justice drop their case against Loeffler but maintain their case against Burr? Could it be because Burr has been an enemy of Donald Trump, even though he is a Republican, because his committee that he used to chair more honest than the other mm-hmm. Republican-led committees about what was going on? And we don't know. Right. And I shouldn't have to ask that question. We should not have a president who openly behaves as if his Justice Department, the U.S. Attorney General Bill Barr, is his own personal hitman.
His own Roy Cohn. And he seemed to have gotten that with Bill Barr because, oh my God, if I had to pick out one key villain of this administration, and there's plenty of candidates, but I think Barr wins it hands down. I've never seen anything like this. By all rights, he should be impeached. And I wonder why the Democrats don't automatically, immediately begin impeachment proceedings against Bill Barr. At least it would hold up the Senate for a couple of days in their quest to rush to confirm Amy Coney Barrett to the Supreme Court.
You know, Bill Barr should have been impeached a while ago.
Yep.
And we can make a long list of what he has done. I'm astonished, again, going back, just tying this back to what Andrew Weissman revealed about the Mueller investigation, mm-hmm. that somehow Mueller trusted Barr. You know, there's this weird way that some of the most educated, buttoned up lawyers cannot see flaws. It cannot understand how power is wielded. Bill Barr wrote, you know, a 20 page memo to audition for his role to become Attorney General. And in it said that he doesn't think a president could ever commit obstruction. Why in the world would, you know, if they were afraid that they were going to be fired by Rod Rosenstein or Bill Barr, how is it possible they could not have anticipated that he was going to gum up the announcement and essentially lie and mislead the people about what the Mueller report actually said? I mean,
that should have done it. The fact that he so misrepresented, lied about what was in that report. And his was the only word we had on what was in it for about a month before they finally finished their redactions and released it so we could judge for ourselves. That is, impeachable behavior right there. And still
and then,
remains.
You know, behavior on what we saw. I'm forgetting the exact date. I think it was September 1st when what was the day when they cleared Lafayette Park?
I don't remember the date, but
I think it was either August 1st or September. It was the first of some month. So much is happening so quickly after the murder of George Floyd.
Yep.
And that he sent, and he lied about it. He sent, you know, basically federal troops in to assault peaceful protesters so the president, to show force and so the president can get a photo op. You know, when is it going to be enough?
Good question. So Jennifer Taub, the question, you're a lawyer. Obviously, if Donald Trump somehow manages to retain the presidency, I don't want to say win re-election because, frankly, I don't think he won election in the first place. And secondly, he won't win. He could steal it. He could, you know, cheat to keep it, but he won't win it. But regardless of the semantics, if he remains in office, is there any hope that we're going to end this epidemic of white collar crime going of draining the swamp, to use his vernacular that he never did?
Wow. That is a hard question. I think even if he does not retain office, we have a lot of work cut out for us. Yeah. But if he retains the office of the presidency, I think it depends upon the composition of the Senate. In that scenario, is it possible that there would be a supermajority in the Senate to impeach? I doubt it. In the scenario you're giving, we're still stuck in the same kind of constitutional crisis, which it's hard to know what the world would look like then. You know, one of my kids said to me yesterday, a teenager said, "Do we have family in Canada?" And I said to her, as she was watching the debate with me, and I said, "We're not going to Canada." So, you know, that's kind of the situation where I am. I'm staying here You know, I think that something to think about is this country was, you know, we had a lot of ideals, but had a hard time living up to them during the, you know, 400 years when slavery, existed and lack of civil rights existed in this country, right? Mm-hmm. So you think about a span of time and you think about what it was like to live here if you were an African-American person, and people didn't just go to Canada because, you know, you can't just leave this country if one of the most powerful, supposedly powerful nations of the world is run by a fascist kleptocrat.
Right.
There's nowhere to run if this is the tendency sweeping the globe. We just have to stay. And I think where I'm hopeful in my book, regardless of who becomes president, is that journalists, I mean, you mentioned, you know, Jason Leopold, I greatly admire him. You know, he is the king of FOIAs, right?
Yes, he is.
And, you know, the people who will keep us safe are journalists and whistleblowers. And, you know, folks like you, we still have the ability to speak our minds. And now is not the time to retreat, even if he sometimes, if he manages to stay in office, now is the time to stand up and be louder and make those voices louder and fight for the country we want this to be.
Now, and then on the other, so that's how crazy it would be if Trump retains the presidency. I obviously have a hard time even spitting out those words. If Joe Biden wins, as you alluded, it's still not going to be easy. Do you have any hope that things would get better? I mean, obviously, when he was vice president, they didn't do the right thing. I mean, the bailout from 2008, I'll tell you, we're still in foreclosure. My house currently, I don't talk about it that much because it's kind of painful, but we're in foreclosure because of COVID. We cut a deal with the bank to stay through the end of January. I don't know what's going to happen after that, but this is all the residual from the 2008 financial crisis. What a euphemism that is for the mortgage meltdown.
Well, let me give you some hope here.
Okay.
In 2008 and 2009, 2010, people were just pushed out of their houses. This time around, with COVID,
yeah,
something's different, where their banks are now negotiating with you. I don't know what happens at the end of the period. You know, I hope that everything works, but it's a little bit better now. So some lessons were learned there. You know, the other thing is, I'm not just going to sit around and hope, right? We need to make change by putting pressure on, you know, Joe Biden's willing to listen. Joe Biden and Harris administration hopefully will listen and look at some of these root causes of the problems we're facing. And I think that the first thing is the healing. The first thing is putting an end to Trumpism and not having a victory for people who have the F your feelings and let people, 200,000 people die without any remorse. Mm-hmm. I think that until we show, you know, I think that I have this idea that, you know, we have this idea that there's, like, on the one hand, not you and me, but sort of the bigger idea of that, you know, oh, there's authoritarian dictatorships that crack down with violence on one extreme and then maybe complete anarchy in no state on the other. Well, no, I mean, what we want is a government, a society, institutions that actively care for people, that lift us up. Can you imagine that?
What
the
idea a concept.
Of shared prosperity.
Yeah, right.
We could be that. And the vast majority of us are people who care for each other. And we should have a government that actively cares for us and not what we have right now. And so I think if starting with caring, I think we can push folks into the right direction to fix these problems.
Who should Joe Biden appoint to be Treasury Secretary?
Elizabeth Warren.
I'm right there with you. I like that. Good answer. Jennifer Taub, the book is called Big Dirty Money. You can find Jennifer on Twitter at Jen Taub. You can find more information about the book at BigDirtyMoney.com, which takes you to JenniferTaub.com. Thank you so much. This is always, it's a tough subject. Again, as we learn from the crickets with the big FinCEN files, I mean, this is a global story that was massive. And yet I've seen nothing about it on the local, you know, the cable news channels or the network news or the front pages, because this stuff goes on all the time and nothing, it seems like nothing is ever done. Thank you for shining a spotlight on it. And maybe now, you know, when we change the administration, we could change more things about going after these criminals who invade every part of our society, and yet we're the ones who get prosecuted for penny ante shit while they, you know, get away with these billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar crimes.
Thank you for having me, and I think we can at least start chipping away at this if we get Biden in office.
Fingers crossed. Knocking on wood laminate. Thank you so much, Jennifer. It was great talking with you. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Jennifer Taub from Big Dirty Money is the name of her book. And looked like our sound was off. All right, so we've got a few minutes left before the end of the show. I've got a few news stories that I didn't get to, and I've got a little story to read. I think I should just give you the news stories that I didn't get to because there's so much going on. One. Let's start with this, and I'm not going to play the ad because you've probably seen it, but Donald Trump is running an ad for for his reelection, in which he uses a soundbite of Dr. Anthony Fauci saying something along the lines of, can't imagine that anybody could be doing more. It's implied that he's talking about Trump. He wasn't talking about Trump. He was talking about the COVID task force when it was still, you know, operational, and Trump refuses to take down the ad. And there are rumors now that there's a new ad that's going to go up that uses another Fauci quote, taking it out of context and misattributing who he was complimenting. I think Fauci is this close to quitting. And I wouldn't fault him for a second. Look, Trump is now not listening to Fauci and instead is relying on Dr. Scott Atlas. He's a radiologist. He reads x-rays. Seriously. So I think Fauci should quit. But first, let Joe Biden know that the minute he is elected, to feel free to call him, he'd be happy to return to work in a Biden-Harris administration. So that's one. Next story. Trump made, obviously, you know, his first appearance at the White House on last Saturday afternoon. Or Saturday afternoon when he hosted between 300 and 400 people on the south lawn of the White House, right? It was his first public event since he was hospitalized after contracting COVID-19 last week. He was scheduled to speak for about 30 minutes. And you know, Donald Trump never walked away from a live microphone until now because he wound up talking for about 18, which is unusual for him. The event was not billed as a campaign rally, but it most certainly was. It was organized by controversial conservative activist Candace Owens and her group Blexit, which urges black Democrats to leave the party. But what we since learned, after seeing pictures, the attendees, according to ABC News, who's reporting this, many of the guests had their travel, lodging paid for and even received a cash stipend for attending from Blexit, this group Blexit. They were all paid to be there. They were also required to wear matching Back the Blue campaign t-shirts and red MAGA hats. And Trump opened his little balcony speech by saying, we got to vote these people into oblivion. So yes, campaign event on White House grounds. Sickening. In California, let me let you in on this. You know how Trump is, you know, screaming about mail-in ballots and fraud. The only fraud that's coming is from the Republicans. California Secretary of State Alex Padilla's office received complaints about what appear to be unauthorized ballot drop boxes in Los Angeles, Orange, and Fresno counties. So, to make a long story short, these boxes appear to have been set up by the California Republican Party. Seriously. This, according to the Orange County Register, citing social media posts, the metal boxes, which purport to be official,
have been reported at local political party offices, churches, and headquarters for Republican candidates. Quote, operating unofficial ballot drop boxes, especially those misrepresented as official drop boxes, is not just misleading to voters, it's a violation of state law. A felony conviction would land perpetrators in prison for 2 to 4 years. This according to Alex Padilla's office. He's the California Secretary of State. Republicans, they point the finger at people for doing what they do on a daily basis. Hypocrites. To take us full circle back to today's bullshit confirmation hearing in the Senate. And round two is tomorrow. Gotta laugh. We'll be here. Lots to talk about. I'll see you then. Thanks for listening, everyone. Bye.